Today, we are going to talk about stakeholders. Before we get into that, a little bit about myself. I have about 15 years of experience in the gaming industry. I'm working as a QA manager right now. I'm a postgraduate in IT management and an ASCQB certified professional. And in my role, again, I've managed teams up to 150 people, working with partners from all across the globe. So that means a lot of stakeholders. Without further ado, stakeholders. So who are stakeholders? Just to understand who are they? They are certainly not everybody on your projects and everybody you see in your office. They are not certainly everybody. That's pretty much for sure. They are the ones who ask you questions, who have some sort of interest or stake in the project that you are working on, and they are the ones who will get impacted by the work that you will be delivering through your project. So that's kind of like a brief description. Why are they important? The projects are done to satisfy stakeholder needs. If they are not satisfied, the project is not a success. They have power and influence over the project. So again, if they are not satisfied, you will not achieve the success. They have the power to, move your project around, kick it out, make changes. So that's why, you need to ensure that they are always satisfied. Again, their satisfaction determines the success and failure. So now we'll look at briefly at the stakeholders that are present in the gaming industry. There are a lot. Gaming is again, becoming kind of like more and more diversified. We have titles being developed all across the world. Just a few talks back, in this room we were talking about, a Canadian company developing games for a Japanese market. So that means, you have, with the gaming becoming more and more complex, development becoming more and more complex, you have more and more stakeholders. So you have stakeholders on the production side of things, then distribution, and then the end user side of things. For the purpose of this talk, we will mainly focus on the stakeholder on the production side of things, which means financiers, publishers, developers, sort of roles. Also, this talk kind of assumes that you are into a production role, which means you are either a producer, manager, senior manager, or some sort of a leadership role in the production area. Again, game user and user research, user acquisition, that's like a whole other topic, and would require another talk probably. Stakeholders, to manage them, first of all, do not manage them. Engage them, and that's the operative word when you're dealing with stakeholders. Again, engagement management is kind of like a whole superset to the project management activities. And if you think about project management, it consists of 5 stages: initiating, planning, executing, monitoring, control, and closure. The stakeholder management kind of sits on top of that. So each step of project management has got a stakeholder engagement activity attached to it. So whether you are planning, you have the stakeholder engagement right from the onset. You create a plan where you bring in people and kind of drive the entire initiative with all that's important to that stage. So that's kind of a brief on how it works. Again, stakeholders can be classified into 4 quadrants. That's the most common method based on their power and impact on the project. Again, from least important and with least power to most important and the highest power. Not to mention, the people with high power and high interest are need to be closely engaged, but that doesn't mean that you can ignore the people with low power and low interest in the project. So how do we engage stakeholders? The standard methodology says, you identify them, understand their needs and interests, which means you go out and conduct interviews. What we usually do in our organization is at the start of every project, we conduct kickoff calls, identify who all needs to be involved, what role they will play, and you know what information they would need at what point of time, and kind of you know drive it accordingly. So again, conducting interviews, understanding their influence and impacts, and then making the effort to gather the requirements that each one of them has and kind of acting accordingly. Planning is important. I mean, without a plan, you can't effectively manage your stakeholders. Again, understanding the requirements is one of the most important aspects of it. We're going to talk about it a little later, which means, you know, just going beyond the verbatim. And again, building an engagement plan, like we talk about who and when of things. And always remember that quality is meeting the expectations of your stakeholders. If you haven't met their expectations, then there is absolutely no quality in your project and the work that you have done. Some of the key challenges that I usually face, and you know, some of the key challenges that come across with when dealing with stakeholders, they may not be communicative, which means you know, don't talk to me, write me anything. I might get to my emails later. Just be on your own. So they may not like talking to you. They may be passive aggressive, which means they may not like the project. They may not like the work environment. They may not like the people in the project, or they may not in the end like you. And how will they react to that? By being non-cooperative. They will not you know, work with you effectively. Anything you tell them, you ask them to do, you know, they will be whatever they will be. May not be sure of the requirements themselves, which means, you know, kind of may tell you, you know, go out, do it on your own, you know, we'll see how it works out, and you know, let's try your way, and you'll hear those sort of answers when people are not sure. So yeah, you may have to put across with those. Have multiple priorities. It's very realistic that one person running multiple projects, he may have other problems in life and may not be really focusing on your project. And may exist in the virtual world only, which means you know, they might be just an email ID, Skype ID, or just like a telephone number for you. And you may not know their personality, know them interpersonally, to actually gauge, you know, what they are all about. So these are some of the standard challenges. We'll now straight away move to some of the key factors that impact stakeholder happiness. Some of these are my experiences that I have faced across my, you know, career as a, like a production guy. Some of the things, out of some of the things that people may get wrong, one of it is, you know, too much requirement focus. Again, we talked about it briefly a little while back, which means, you know, sticking to the really verbatim of the requirement and really, really not being invested in the project, not understanding, you know, what's kind of needed. And to explain it further, you know, I'll kind of give an example from my personal life, something that happened to me about a few months back. I was kind of, you know, getting my house renovated, and I had this vendor who was kind of renovating my kitchen. So I kind of gave him some requirements on how the work needs to be done. And when he gave me the final product, the work wasn't kind of, you know, meeting my expectations. It didn't look fine. So I asked the guy, you know, this doesn't look good. So he said, yeah, but you asked me to do so. I said, couldn't you have done it better? He said, I could have, but you asked me to do so. I said, didn't you know? Yes, I did, but you asked me to do so. And that kind of gave me the thinking that, you know, is this the best answer that we give when people come across with concerns, when they come across with problems? Do we tell them, you asked me to do so? And that's where, you know, sometimes we miss the boat. We really, really, you know, end up not investing ourselves into the project as much as we should, really doing our research and really finding out why that thing is being asked out of me and why are we kind of, you know, doing what we are doing. And this is where, you know, we have to invest ourselves at least a step further than, you know, what's kind of being written over the word pattern. So again, not understanding the need, where you totally miss the boat, you just go with the requirement verbatim and do what has been kind of asked. Over-ambition is another one of the biggest problems I've seen, at least in gaming industry in my career. I've seen project fail because of that. You know, people, we have this kind of like human tendency to, you know, keep making things bigger, and sometimes people tend to get carried away with that. You may start up with a small, much simpler design doc, a much smaller plan, and as you go along with the cycle, you just like keep adding things on top of each other. And the next thing you know, your costing has gone up the roof, your deadlines are out of the window, you are, you know, pretty much everywhere. And there is no, you know, there is no way to kind of control that. This is where you have to be very, very realistic. Before you take another step in adding to the core plan of the project, you may want to ask yourself questions, you know, do I really, really need that? Do I, you know, is it really going to add to the value of the project? And you have to also learn to control other people's ambitions as well, because sometimes people may come asking you for things, you know, which are kind of not realistic, which are kind of not, you know, not adding up to the project. And you have to be there as a project manager, as a center of things, to, you know, kind of push back and say, you know, this is not going to work. And, sometimes clarify and, you know, make sure that things remain under control. Next is the inform and not inform dilemma, which is in the word of famous author, famous writer, he said, you know, human mind is an artist, it fills in the information gaps. And that's where, you know, you need to know. Every time you are not informing, somebody is sitting out there assuming things. Somebody is just like putting up, you know, your half information into something that actually might not be. Some of the reasons that might lead that to happen is, you know, when the project manager or the manager becomes a miserly informer, which basically arises out of, you know, again, the tendency, if you know something, you assume that somebody else knows that thing too. And you really don't, you know, take the effort. You might be lazy as well to kind of go out and inform and kind of make sure that the information channels are being fulfilled. One thing that we have to really, really, you know, understand and remember always is that successful products, successful organizations, they always run on the flow of information. And if we kind of fail to, you know, channelize that information from one source to the other, the project may not come out to be all that great. So again, that's one of the major things, that any information you get, you pass it on. Even if you are going a little overboard is better than being under informing. Another syndrome is autopilot thinking, which means, you know, you are very, very transactional. You deal with day-to-day problems and really not think about, you know, what's going beyond that. So you are always caught up in some sort of problem, some sort of things that are going wrong, and you really fail to look at the bigger picture that's kind of happening behind it. One thing to overcome that I would suggest is start writing. That has helped me a lot in my life. When you write, it gives a form to your thoughts. And then it also gives you a point to go back to and realign yourself. Otherwise, you will always be, you know, kind of drifting in all directions, missing out the critical opportunities and the critical points in your project. So again, try and be communicative, try and have a process and communicate as often as, you know, as possible. and be true to your processes rather than, you know, being everywhere around. Another thing that you know most managers struggle with is informing the bad news. You know, as humans, we have, you know, built-in defense mechanism. We avoid confrontation. We avoid, you know, really going out and, you know, telling something that we know that, you know, may backslash and may kind of hit us back. So that's where, you know, we have to be kind of careful. We have to, as a project manager, you know, one thing we have to be very, very sure of, it's not as safe a job as being working at a kind of like a, you know, a low level position. Management is a risky job. And the project manager has to be able to, you know, take those risks. Otherwise, if you always take the, you know, the safer route, it might not work. And this is where, you know, you have to be kind of careful, because again, informing will help more than not informing. The cultural iceberg, flipping on its own. The cultural iceberg, again, there was one iceberg that kind of sank the Titanic. The cultural iceberg can sink a project. So, to kind of, you know, understand it, first we need to understand what is culture. Culture is kind of like someone's personal belief system. You know, some things that you do certainly, and you kind of, you know, it's kind of there to help your subconscious mind. So suppose, you know, you wake up, you brush your teeth, you eat. Someone may wake up, may eat, and then brush the teeth later. Those are like common items, but again, it's set up in different cultures. The best thing about culture is you really don't know about your culture. You only get to know when you are put across to another culture. And the first thing that happens is, you know, start defending, you know, start create a tough challenge, you know, those people, they are like that, and you know, we do it like this, and they are doing it like that, they are crazy. This is where, you know, we may end up wasting time and energy on the project. We have to make sure that, you know, we are very, very understanding of other people's work practices, ethics, cultures. Again, we were talking about the way the Japanese people work. They have a certain way of working. They are very detail oriented, but that may not align with other people. And, you know, people in the West, they might not be as detail oriented with documentation and stuff like that. But again, you know, while working with that sort of a culture, you have to be understanding and mindful. Culture is again important because it brings in perspectives, it brings in, it challenges the stereotype, and you know, it makes sure that you know, each problem has got different perspectives to solve it, and that's where, you know, you need to kind of maintain and balance your own cultural openness. Some people think of culture as being, you know, being open to other cultures as being double standards, but that's kind of not the case. Again, I think, you know, if you are open to other cultures, you live better. You understand, you grasp, you absorb, and you experience a lot more things than, you know, just by being close to things. The primary emotion in life should be acceptance and not rejection. Some other things that are important: building relations. Again, it makes things so much easier when you have good relations going around with people that you work with. And how do you build relations? By working for people. You build your reputation, your relations by working for people. When you work for long enough, you deliver good results, that's when, you know, your reputation level rises and you start building good relations. So again, interpersonal relations are important. You know, build really, really close relations with the people you are working for it. One way of doing it is being really, really caring about it. Taking is just too easy. Care about the people around you, and that will kind of lead a way to better relations with the people. Personal prejudices are bad. They spoil relations. That's where I would kind of like to discuss a concept that I kind of read a little while back, and I think it made a lot of sense to me. It was a concept about having zero self-esteem, which doesn't have to be confused with having no self-esteem or a low self-esteem, or hating yourself or trying to kill yourself or anything. Zero self-esteem, what it generally means is not telling yourself how good you are. And what that does is, when you stop telling yourself, and that's how the marketing companies sell things to us, right? And you are so special, by this, they massage your self-ego. And what it does is it kind of lays down your self-ego. And once that is done, you stop attaching emotions to your delivery, your projects, and you start looking beyond that to the facts and the reality of things. And it, the way it also helps is, when you start looking at the reality, the way it helps is that even if your ideas are shot down, even if people say bad things about you, you are not hurt, you are not attached to them, and you tend to improve more. You'll go back taking them seriously and trying to work on them in a better form. Junior designations matter, which means loyalty up, is loyalty down, which means always pass on the information to your guys. Don't leave them in the dark. Let them know what's going on. Give them the bigger picture always. That also comes as your commitment towards your future. And when you are committed, they will be committed back to you. So again, it relates to the total information flow, which has to go up and down both ways. Negotiation skills. The literal meaning of negotiation skills is coming to a consensus, which means whenever you have conflicts, don't avoid them, don't run to them, always work out a consensus. Don't leave things out in the open. Either convince or get convinced. That is how it has to be. If you leave things in the open, the calls will remain as it is. It will gonna waste time and energy for everybody, and will not gonna yield the results it should. Humor rocks. Again, in the words of our famous poet, humor is the shortest distance between two people. Learn to laugh at your mistakes. Very, very important. It doesn't put you in bad light. It shows that you are caring and concerned about and aware about your shortcomings. It also releases tension, eases the pressure, and makes sure that everybody stays in close touch. But again, use humor with care. Avoid any political, sexist, personal attacks or anything like that. That could be seen bad. Also, if you can't be humorous yourself, at times let others be humorous. Don't spoil it for others. If somebody else is humorous, be open to other people's jokes and learn to laugh along. Laughter can solve a lot of things. So just to sum it up, the key points: to manage your stakeholders, keep a high quality touch with everyone, especially the high impact stakeholders, which means going beyond verbatim, maintaining relations, going back and asking if they were asking for something, why they were asking, and understanding your stakeholders better than just some written sort of thing. Build a communication channel and be a part of it. Flow of information is important for a successful project. So you need to be at and it always understand and anticipate the needs other than being just overbudgeting requirement focused. We talked about that earlier. Teach yourself to put yourself in other shoes and think from different perspectives before, you know, really going out and going all out. Be prepared to take the heat when you're working on a project. It's going to happen at some point in time. Somebody will get angry and pissed off with you. Learn to tackle with a calm mind. If somebody is really attacking you, the best way that I find is maybe to step back. Really not go out and, you know, attack, answer attack with another attack. When things settle down a bit, we may ask for clarifications later, which will help you, you know, break down the problem that the person is having with you and solve it in one by one manner. Throw your ego out of the window. Nobody cares about your emotions anyways. Nobody cares about it. What people really, really care about is what you can deliver and what you can work on. That's important. Look down on your work habits than justifying. And last but not the least, the better you can manage your stakeholders, the more quality you will drive in your work. And the more stakeholders you can manage, the more, you know, you will end up growing in the end. And that's pretty much quick kind of talk. Thank you.
Things you talk about keeping your ego out of the window and whatever. But on the other hand, there's also things like caring about the product or like not being like very centered around like the human aspects, but more about progress and generating value in a way. But what if the conflicts are because of that? As a person who's trying to keep all the personal things aside, but your stakeholders are, as a group people, there's decisions being made which are sort of not good for the product or progress. And then the conflict is that, because there are some people who want the overall project or everything to be better, but then there's on the other hand stakeholders of people who are kind of like on a different, so being on the other camp also causes the conflict. So how do you deal with that? It's kind of meta.
So that's something I kind of discussed, and these are the conflicts in my life I've seen mostly happen between the finance and the production, because a production wants a certain quality, they want to put in a certain thing, and the finance wants to always keep cutting costs down and you know, keep things in check. Again, that's what I said. You know,
but they both are right.
Yeah, both are right. Yeah. You have to learn to come to a consensus at some point. Either you have to, and again, when you are dealing with the issues, again, putting your emotions aside and really, really be factual. You know, suppose if you are dealing with the finance, you know, just putting down the financial impact on it.
But who is the stakeholder there? Because what you're asking for is maturity, emotional maturity on all levels, on all parties. But you can't expect the same everywhere. And in this case, so you've got two different, like, they're each other's stakeholders in a way. But like, who's the? Is there a concept of primary stakeholder versus like you? Where does it? Production versus
absolutely.
Production.
When you are working on a project, everybody is
sure. Yeah.
But again, you know, that's what I said at the start of the topic. It's about you as in a production role. You are a producer,
sure.
And or you are a production manager, or you are a project manager who is kind of trying to deliver what's best for the project. But at the same time, you know, you have to learn to appreciate the realism of the entire situation. You can't be, you know, invested outside at a time. So if you are really, really interested into your project and you have a really, really good case, you know, justifying that, you know, this is something that I need, and that's what I'm saying, you know, finance, put a value on it. You know, if I'll do this, you know, this will make the project better. This will probably mean, you know, this much n number of revenue and better quality and better user experience. So sometimes that kind of helps. But again, if you don't get emotional about it, if somebody, you're going to respond to somebody's emotions with emotions, it's not going to cut it for you. You're going to put yourself in a weaker position, and then negotiating can't happen. Negotiating only happens when you put your emotions out, you put out the realistic values, and you kind of, you know, work your way around and come to a meeting point. And that's where I said, you know, don't leave things in the open. If you are in a conflict, you know, always either get convinced or have a better argument to convince other people. If you don't have it, then get convinced that's the only way to kind of be realistic and make people happy. What questions?
I had a question. So it's as you think a person can, and the stakeholder is kind of shielding the, I'm sorry, the functional manager is shielding the stakeholder. So what do you do now?
You mean the junior designation?
Yeah.
Feedback, be true. That's the best thing. If somebody has made a mistake, you know, you must go back and tell them.
Yes,
and if there is somebody shielding you, again that plays back onto your negotiation skills. You know, you have to go and tell them, boss, this is not doing good to the project, and this is how I want things to be, this is what our end goals are, and this is how, you know, that underperformance is kind of derailing my end outcome. So you have to be very, very realistic, very, very factual, and go out and give the real feedback. Really don't sugarcoat it. Even if the, you know, you feel that you are going to get into a very heated argument, you're gonna, you know, have a fight with a person, put your bravest face and put yourself, and that's where, you know, have a zero self-esteem, cut all the emotions out, you know, go out with the facts and just deal with it. Because again, not dealing with it will create more problems. So yeah, that's, hope that answers your question.
Yeah, that was a good answer. And so say, even after you convince the functional manager, the same thing happens. So what next step do you think you can actually take?
So this, I mean, you have ended up convincing and the person still keeps underperforming?
Yeah.
Still, be realistic. Go back and tell that this is not working out.
So do you think that we should take it to HR maybe or something like that?
Absolutely.
So that would be the logical step.
Exactly. Whatever your company policy says to meet up, or whatever, you know, is the right process that you have laid down to meet up under performance, please, you know, go back and deal with those issues as per your policy. Again, having a written rule really, really helps. That's my personal experience, rather than being ad hoc. Because when you are being ad hoc and you really don't have something concrete defined to, let's say, an issue like underperformance, people may tend to take things for a ride. You know, they'll be whatever they will be, you know. And interpersonal relations can sometimes override the actual, you know, nature. And then that's another good reason why so many companies go down, because, you know, people stick together with so long for wrong reasons. You know, nobody is performing, nobody is adding anything to the project, and you are just, you know, falling with your interpersonal relations, you are creating your own fantasies and, you know, building your own unrealistic plans and, you know, not meeting them in the end, and that actually makes the organizations fail, that they, you know, leave the core of, ask yourself, right, the way you come to work is that project, and the real reason behind your being there is that project, and if that project's necessities are not being met, you know, any interpersonal relation or anything is not doing any good.
Thanks.